Good morning, I'm Jeffrey H. Haskell, and welcome to today's Writestream. I will be working on Grimm's War Book 2 today, and the... brain freeze. the scene I'm working on is I'm about at the first plot point of Act 2, and if you aren't familiar with writing, what that means is that every act is broken into events. So if you think about, you know, your favorite movie, the movie opens with a scene, and then about 15 minutes in, about 5 or 10 minutes in, something happens. It kind of starts the adventure, and then about 10 minutes after that, something happens. It sort of sends it on a new way, in a different direction. And then that's the beginning of the second act, and the second act is just three versions of that. How am I through today? Sorry. So I'm in the first plot point of the second act, which means that it's, you know, to be technical, it's called the tri-fail cycle. The heroes are trying to fix the problem, something happens, it doesn't work, or it does work, but it doesn't work the right way, and they move on. And so I'm at the big first plot point where something new is discovered, and it sends the story in a different direction. Chapter 19, I think. And so that's what I'm working on today. So I'm briefly doing a scene from a POV of a character who is not important to the story, really, other than I'm using him as a way to show the rest of the characters from an outside perspective. I don't want to say in detail too much what's going on because I started write streaming this book like halfway through. And so you can kind of read along with me, or you just sort of watch, you know, speed the video up the two times and watch it. I'll make comments as I go along and let you know what I'm doing. I'm going to record and post this in real time. It's 7:19 a.m. my time. I had to do some administrative work right now, and I get to work until 8:45. So basically I get like an hour and a half. And in that time I should be able to do 2,500 words. I'm at Carl's Jr. in Caldwell, Idaho, which is where I live. There's no music playing in the background, so I don't have to do what I did the other day, which is have a music, royalty-free music playing while I write. Let me think here. Was there anything else I need to say? I am 50,000 words in, which is pretty good. Another 10,000 words, and I'll be at the story's halfway point. I was thinking it was at the halfway point the other day, and then I realized no, you weren't. So I'm gonna leave that in. Yeah. So there we go. All right. Wish me luck. Here we go. So as you can see, this dude right here, operator tier 3, he did his boss, he did all middle management. I had this set up a different way, but this is a much better sentence. And sometimes you just need to get sentences out, and then you come back and you look at it and you go, oh, okay, I can do that better. And that's what editing is all about. So bear that in mind as we go along, that not every sentence is going to stay in. All right, here we go. Oh, I'm listening to music, so that's all I'm doing is putting on my music. I don't think you're going to be able to hear it, at least I hope not, because then I'll have to mute everything, because the copyright will be ruined. Because, you know how YouTube is with copyright. You can't listen to music. Well, I shouldn't complain because I benefit from copyright rules. So there's that. All right, let's have to listen to something else because what song I was listening to Red Balloon by Charlie XCX from Home. I know it's a weird song to listen to while you're writing, but I love that song. None of my music is working. I wonder. All right, I guess we're doing this without music. Enjoy. I don't always know how to spell every word. Just, you know, FYI. Sometimes my brain freezes. And that's every writer ever. Oh, I should mention, I mentioned this in other streams, but just in case you haven't seen those, I have ADD and I'm dyslexic. So those are two things that suck to be a writer. And so I have to, on top of medicine I take for my ADD, I have to write on a pink background with Comic Sans in order to catch as many errors as possible. Something about the Comic Sans, every character is unique. The each character doesn't, like the J has nothing in common with the T, and the C has nothing in common with the B. They're uniquely different. So it allows me to see the letters much better. I'm keeping it a try. There's actually a font exactly for dyslexia that I haven't tried yet, but I will. And I'll do really hard, work really hard to get rid of all the uhs and ums. You know, I'm a public speaker. I'm a trained public speaker. I just haven't had to do it for a while. So old habits die hard. As soon as you stop public speaking, all those filler words, as they're called, come back up. And yeah, that's definitely one of them. You hear people talking in the background again. I'm at Carl's Jr., sorry. Anyway, these guys are talking. I'm actually going to mute my mic because I don't want you to, I don't want to eavesdrop, so to speak. People left, so turn my mic back on. So what I'm trying to do is set up the idea that the guild is, there's the again. The guild is not a monolith, right? Races aren't a monolith. Nations aren't a monolith. Clearly, if you're following along in current news today in the U.S., not a monolith. There are good people on every side of every argument. There were good people in Nazi Germany. There are good people in Stalin Russia. There just was more bad people. So the thing to remember is that when you're writing, okay, so the good thing remembered is when you're writing characters and you're writing countries and nations and sides, that it's much more realistic if there are people on every side who have a gamut of emotions, right? So in my, Grimm's War world, we've got the Alliance, we've got the Consortium, we've got the Iron Empire and the Caliphate. Those are the major ones. And then you've got the Guild, who nobody knows about really. And in my head, the Alliance and the Consortium are the quote unquote good guys, and the Guild and the Caliphate are the bad guys. But life is more complicated than that. So while there isn't any question about who the good guys are and who the bad guys are, and the bad guys are very bad, there are good people who are on the side of the bad guys because that's the country they were born in. Jordan Peterson talks about how he has this great talk about how, like, you'd be a Nazi. If you were born in Germany, if you were alive in Germany in a time, you'd be a Nazi. You'd like to think that you wouldn't be, but you would be. Even if you were a good person. And it's the hardest thing in the world to admit that if you were born in a time, that you would be just like everybody else in that time. There'd be nothing special about you. And once you realize that, it helps you guard against the kind of behavior that leads to those sort of things. Captain Kirk, I'm a huge Star Trek fan, and Captain Kirk once said in an episode about these people who didn't want to fight a war, they just wanted to kill people that were monsters, were murderers, were barbarians. But it's important to remember that we wake up each day, we're just not going to kill today. I'm not going to take anybody's life today. That's all it takes. All right, back to the story. Probably haven't read the first book since it's not out yet, but the Caliphate is this Islamic government that runs the slave trade. And if you think that, like, Jeff, it's 1,000 years from now, that won't still happen. Well, it's been happening for the last 2,000 years, so I don't really see how it'll be any different in the next 1,000 years. It's still happening today. Last I read, there were over 30,000 European and American slaves in the hands of Middle Eastern people, Islamic people in the Middle East. It's not racist or whatever, it's just facts. Human trafficking is a huge problem in the United States and in the world. It's a huge problem. And thousands of Americans every year are trafficked out of this country for purposes of sex. So it bothers me tremendously that that's still going on today. So I tend to write about that stuff. Anyway, so yeah, so the obedience collars are just their futuristic way of making sure that their slaves don't revolt. So in science, there's this mechanic called, it's fairly cutting edge, it's called a gravity manifold. And it's these spots in space where things go faster than they should. And they think that in the future, they're going to be able to use these gravity manifolds to bounce ships around from Earth to the outside of the solar system 10 times faster than Voyager took. So Earth to Pluto a few years as opposed to a few decades like Voyager was. And so my idea is, since they do a lot of gravity stuff, is that they use these manifolds to travel between star systems, connecting two star with two stars connecting. This star is a little different, as you'll see. My fingers are cold this morning, so. I mean, I think everybody knows this, but once in a while I'm amazed at the little things that sometimes people don't know. But whenever you see asterisks, and I don't know if there'll be asterisks in the final book or not, that's up to Aethon, the guys who are publishing these books, because they're doing the formatting. But I'd like it if it was little rocket ships. That'd be cool. But it's a scene break, right? And a scene break it's not a new scene. It's a break from this scene to another scene that is happening either simultaneously or within a set amount of time. So I wouldn't do a scene break and say 7 days later. That would be a new chapter, at least for me anyways, and from what I've read. So I tend to use scene breaks as meanwhile or happening about the same time. So I've got my B plot, which is Katarina Dagger and this ship called the Ghost, which is a stealth ship that nobody else has with the guild. I tend to write those two scenes together so that when people are reading the book, they'll get to the B plot and they'll go, okay, I know that these two plots are tied together and this progresses them. And then they also know that they'll get back to the regular plot, you know, post haste. It's always tricky having multiple POVs. You got to make them all interesting and have them all doing something. Otherwise, you get the situation, and you still will get the situation. There's no amount of, you can't always please everybody, but you'll get situations where there's that situations where people don't like characters, and they will change. They'll turn the page, and they'll be like, okay, I don't like this character. I don't want to read about this character's POV. I'm just going to skip ahead until it's not this character's POV anymore. And sort of a catch 22, that POV is there to provide you with information. And you need to make sure that it's interesting enough for the readers that they don't feel compelled to skip it. Someone told me once recently, and I was really surprised to get this piece of advice, but they said, don't use then. And I was like, why not? And he said it's a word that slows the action. And it hadn't occurred to me that that was the case. And maybe that's something that everybody else knew. I didn't know, but thank you, Rick Partlow, for sharing me your wisdom. For those of you who don't know, the Marines tend to stand guard on the captain's door, wherever the captain is, basically, on a ship. Marines will stand guard. And there are only four Marines on this destroyer. There used to be more, but they were transferred off. And so there's Sergeant Allison Jennings is one of my favorite characters. Lance Corporal Akola Matthew, who is like Asian, Hawaiian, Pacific Islander. There we go. And then PFC Kyle Owens. Though I don't think I've said his name before, first name before, in the book. The Interceptor is a very small destroyer. It's not a big ship. And if you've ever seen or been on a destroyer, you know how close and compartmentalized and tight everything is. There's not a lot of extra room. More people are talking, so I'm gonna go mute while I'm ready. may have noticed that my word count updated. I'm almost at 1,000 words right now, and it's been like 40 minutes. That's pretty good. Okay, we're gonna call it there. I gotta get home and take care of the kids. You'll notice the last. So if you can guess, Yumi is Lieutenant Senior Grade Kimiko Yumi is Japanese, Asian descent. She's Shinto, and she's from a planet called Ronin. It's in the Alliance. But the major Asian influenced nation is the Consortium. And they are actually about 1,000 light years away from the Alliance through the Orion arm down to the Sagittarius arm. They were, man, I'm really going with the O's today. Sorry. Anyways, they were sort of the odd people out. Yorin was. They meant to go to the Consortium, but they ended up in Alliance space. It wasn't Alliance space at the time. They were one of the founding members. There's a whole bunch of history there. But anyways, the word that she says is a swear word, which you'll notice there aren't any swear words in my books, or not often. I can't 100% say sure there isn't any what some might consider a swear word. However, in the Alliance, when I was in the Army, they had a very strict no swearing policy. We were not allowed to swear, which is weird because if you think of the military, you're like, well, everybody in the military swears. Well, at the time, the Army was trying to clean up its act. So officers and non-coms were not allowed to swear in front of enlisted. And enlisted would get busted for swearing by their non-coms. I don't know if that's still the case. I don't think it is, because when you go to war for a long time, yeah, you don't enforce rules like that. That's crap rules that will ruin your morale. However, that was a long time ago, and I don't swear anymore for a lot of reasons, mostly because I've come to realize that that kind of vulgarity is often inappropriate, is rarely appropriate. So, also, a second reason is my religion, and a third reason is my children. I want them to read these books and enjoy them, and so I keep the subject matter PG-13. And, you know, also when you listen to audiobooks, swearing is a lot different than when you're reading it, because when you're reading it, you can kind of edit out the swearing in your head, but when you're listening to an audiobook, you can't edit it out. And I've had to put down a number of audiobooks because the author just loved the F word. Hey, if you're not me, that's fine. And I'm not like getting on anybody's case for there being no swearing or whatever, or there being swearing or whatever. That's just, you know, that's author preference or reader preference. Personally, this is my preference. So the word she used is the Japanese word for holy S word, which is not from the English to Google translator. It's from a website about Japanese swear words. They were all helpfully asterisked out. It's the kind of research you need to do, because Google Translate's great, but it won't work for a lot of stuff. And you really should be sparingly use words from a different language. When I was a baby writer, I thought that putting in other words from other languages would reinforce that person had an accent or whatever. And rereading it years later, I realized what a huge mistake that was. It's like when you watch a movie and there's a Hispanic character and, you know, every other word out of his mouth is, hey, S.A., or a Spanish word or something. And it's like a reminder that character's Hispanic. I had a French character in one of my books called Intruder, and I really was in love with her being French, and so like every other word out of her mouth was French. And rereading it years later after I had written it, I realized, oh, hey, that was a huge mistake. So at some point I'll probably rewrite that book just because it's really awesome and remove a lot of that French dialogue and just remind people that she's speaking with a French accent. So it was kind of like my Wyatt Earp in space is what it was. But yeah, it was pretty cool. My editor said that it was one of the best books he'd read for creating tension where you feel like the main character's life is truly in danger. And it was me learning how to write tension, believe it or not. So that's why it feels that way. Okay, everyone, I'm going to get rolling. I got to take care of my kids. And, you know, this has been great. I think I hit in an hour and 15 minutes of actual writing, I think I hit, 1,500 words. So that's right where I want to be for this kind of work. The third person narrative with multiple POVs and a lot of science. You're going to love what comes next. I mean, I did. Bear in mind, almost everything in these books, science-wise, is heavily researched. I'm no scientist. I love science. I love reading about science. I love, took a couple of 300 level science classes in college that I didn't graduate from. So, but I always read, being a huge fan of science fiction growing up my whole life, I read a lot of science stuff. I've consulted with a couple of physicists, one from NASA, one whose father worked on the Apollo program. So she's really, really super smart. Thank you, Lisa Richmond. And I've tried to verify everything on it. There are a couple of things that just basically aren't science. The graph coils just aren't, there's just nothing there. It's science fiction. I mean, it's completely fiction. Virtually everything else in the book, though, even the gravity manifolds that get you from the star lanes, that make up the star lanes, all right out of theoretical or actual science that we know now. So what comes next is actual science that we know now, but it's right on the cutting edge, so it's pretty cool. Everybody, have a great day, and thanks for joining me on this writing journey. See you next Writestream.